Everybody knows the story about me getting a small table for a Christmas present 2 weeks before my sort of 13th birthday. I improved really quickly. I had my first century when I was 13 on a full-size table. You know, it was just one of them things where I guess I was born to play snooker. We qualified for Junior Pot Black, and to be going on national television when you're 14 was amazing.
Coming to the table is the little giant of snooker, looking even younger than his 14 years.
So I played well without making big breaks, but I potted lots of balls. I remember I wasn't nervous. You know, I just enjoyed it. I didn't feel any nerves at all being in front of cameras or the audience. I think between my father and my manager at the time, Ian Doyle, we decided that I had nothing more to learn as an amateur. Let's just go in and with the big boys and see how it goes, basically. The most important detail for me, obviously my father had looked after me through my whole junior and amateur ranks, but when you become a professional, there's so much more involved in terms of the travelling and booking hotels and the costs and everything, so you needed someone else to sort of take care of that side of things. When I turned professional at 16, I won the Scottish professional title in my first attempt. So having won that, I qualified to play Jimmy White, you know, my idol, in the first match. And I lost 5-0. I was just sat in my chair in awe of Jimmy White. I was just like, you know, I can't believe I'm playing my hero. I just admiring him. You know, I had to get out of the mindset of thinking these were my heroes. They weren't my heroes anymore, they were opponents.
That you can improve your cue ball control, you can improve everything by practice, but most of all you can improve the concentration. And you must learn. You don't go on practice tables at tournaments with players. Now seriously, you've got to stay away from them. Most of the top players know how good you are. Let them worry till match day. Let them sweat it out. You don't want to be building up their confidence.
The only way to learn is by losing and playing better players, because you learn from better players. I mean, I did a couple of tours with Steve in Scotland, like 6-night tours where he hammered me every night, but I learned so much from those.
I was starting to see a few prospects coming through, and Stephen really was just another one. But little did I know that the kid I was bashing up in exhibition play up in Scotland and using as cannon fodder every night would become the most dominant force in the game of snooker.
Steve Davis was the number one player. And it wasn't the fact of copying him technically, it was more like copying the way he went around his career. You know, basically just devoting your whole life to being the best and being number one. Steve didn't talk to anyone in those days, so you know, he would say hello, shake your hand and then beat you. I think he wanted to basically teach me a lesson. Yeah, I beat Steve Davis on the way to the Grand Prix in Reading, my first major ranking event.
And that's enough, the world champion and favourite for this tournament has been toppled by the 18-year-old young Scottish sensation, Stephen Hendry.
But the UK, and that was the first time I'd beaten Steve over a long distance, and that was a major breakthrough for me, because I don't think he believed I could beat him over a long frame match. Yeah, she's a promise in
the year of election. The young 20-year-old Scott gains everything he set out to do.
I'd beaten all the other players, and he was the sort of last player that I had to sort of dominate. And once I'd beaten him a couple of times, then you start to think, oh, you know, I've got to measure him now. The first one is obviously special. It's your ambition to be world champion, or it was my ambition. And I actually said, a quote when I was 16, that my aim is to be world champion by the time I'm 21. And I achieved that. I won the world championship when I was 21. So that was obviously special. And obviously to this, so still the youngest to this day.
The youngest ever champion.
Talk to people about Stephen. I liken him to the biggest, meanest, most aggressive killing machine of a white shark that there's ever been.
Stephen goes out in a blaze of glory. He becomes the 1992 Embassy World Champion for a second time. And what a miraculous performance by a 23-year-old boy from Scotland.
Stephen Hendry has proved once again that he's the best player in the world.
What can I say apart from happy birthday?
He's beginning to annoy me.
There was a time in the 90s, obviously, where I felt totally invincible. I mean, almost taking it for granted, winning the Crucible. There was a couple of occasions where, before I left for the first round, I said to my wife, Mandy, I said, can you bring that jacket? I want to wear that for the party after the final. And this is before I've even started the tournament, but I just expected to win.
Stephen Hendry becomes the Embassy World Snooker Champion for the sixth time. A fabulous performance as he salutes the capacity crowd here.
Then to win the seventh world title, obviously to break the records, that was just incredible.
It's a magnificent seven times for Stephen Hendry in the 90s.
I won the world championship against Mark Williams to win the seventh world title, but that season was a poor season, and I'd started to become, you know, not as consistent in my winning. Obviously, winning breeds confidence, and then losing sort of destroys it.
Four. Peter Ebdon, four.
I was going longer periods in between winning tournaments. You know, it'd be maybe a few months, then all of a sudden it'd be a year, 2 years, 3 years. So your confidence goes into decline. Because you're used to winning so much, I think it affects you even more. Losing my original cue was a big thing, certainly mentally, because it was the cue I'd won everything with. Maybe unconsciously it gives you an excuse to sort of say this is why, but you know, I don't really put it all down to the cue. You know, perhaps I wasn't working as hard as I was in the 90s in terms of practicing. My life was changing. You know, I had a family. You know, your priorities change. You don't hurt as much when you lose because you have to go home and your children are there, your wife's there. And you know, when I was single and losing, you could go home and sulk for days and it didn't matter. You know, you didn't see anybody. But when you see your children, that is impossible to sulk. Yeah, my snooker career wasn't going the way I wanted it to go. It was just grinding me down. Enough was enough, basically. I'm officially retired now from tournament snooker. I made the decision about 3 months ago. I only told two or three people, but yeah, this is me finished from tournament snooker.
What an ambassador he has been for our game of snooker, and he's helped to grow the game all over the world. Wherever he's gone, he's been very, very popular. And well done to the King of the Crucible.
I think that the snooker world will just respect this man for what he's achieved. was something special. The best player, the best match player, the best competitor I've ever known.
I've had so many great memories. You know, youngest world champion, three maximums. Fantastic champion, the greatest player he's ever game. Going to miss him. I'm sure we'll do some exhibitions together. You know, he's a top guy. He's had a fantastic career.
I think that we should just be very, very thankful that we've had somebody of his calibre, of his class, that has been able to take the game to new heights.
At the end of the day, the record books will tell you what Stephen Hendry was, and it will leave a hole in snooker. Just like to thank him on behalf of everybody for making the game popular and keeping it popular.
It's for people's opinion who's the best player, but as long as I'm in that discussion, then, you know, I've done all right.
I played snooker very aggressively, fearlessly. If there was a pot on, no matter how crazy it looked, I took it on. I would like to think that I changed the way snooker was played.
A lot of people would have taken up snooker and wanted to play the Stephen Hendry way, you know, and that includes the greats like O'Sullivan, the likes of Higgins and Williams as well, who have won all those titles between them. He inspired them, he inspired me, and his legacy will live on.
As they say, the years pass by, but the legend is eternal.